Any alarm, Music and stuff, yeah. Yeah. But I was also told that if you hear an alarm just once, that we should ignore it. That's a malfunction. The real alarm will be continuous. But there's no planned drill today. So thank you very much for coming. Without further waste of time, we're going to go to the next item on the program, which is a welcoming address and introduction of SpringRock Group by the chairman and CEO of the SpringRock Group, Mr. AKUA. Thank you.
Very senior executives of different oil and gas organizations, some dignitaries associated with publications in the oil and gas industry, my colleagues from SpringRock. On behalf of myself, my name is AKUAK. I'd like to welcome you all to this event this evening, which is the launching of SpringRock Gemini Resources, along with our proprietary human talent development program, which we call the Talent Track. Let me also mention that in your program, you noticed that after my welcome, there was supposed to be an announced by Simbi Wapote. Unfortunately, Simbi had to be called off to go and engage with the National Assembly. And this actually occurred late yesterday evening, and they couldn't make an alternative arrangement. That's why Cindy is not here, but I believe that he's somehow here with us in spirit. So that item in the program will be skipped. SpringRock was put together not too long ago. So normally one would say it's a new company, but we prefer to refer to ourselves as a young company, not a new company. And as we all know, in putting together an organization, there are typically questions that you ask. The first question normally is to say, why the company? And after you've articulated why the company, then you ask yourself, what and how? There's some arguments on whether how should come before what or what should come before how. What I've said that second, what's most important is that why should come before the other ones. So in articulating why SpringRock, we drew an inspiration from an event that occurred a couple of years ago. An American archaeologist was doing excavation in New York, and they dug quite a large space of area, and they continued digging until they got to 10 feet. At 10 feet, they encountered a very extensive network of cables. They stopped, and they decided to do some analysis. They found out that those cables were more than 100 years old. They also found out that those cables were communication cables. And they did further analysis. And they published a report that said, more than 100 years ago, New York City had a sophisticated communication network. Soon after that publication was made, not to be outdone, a British archaeologist began excavating in London. They dug and dug until 10 feet. They did not find anything. They continued to dig until about 20 feet. They encountered some cables and they started to do some analysis. They found out that those cables were at least 200 years old and that they were communication cables. They did further testing and they concluded and published a result that said more than 200 years ago that London had a very extensive and sophisticated communication network. So soon after that report was published, not to be outdone, a Nigerian archaeologist began excavating here in Lagos. So they dug to 10 feet, they didn't find anything. They kept digging to 20 feet, they did not find anything. And they continued digging. And at 30 feet, they still didn't find anything. They went ahead to do their test and analysis, and they published their report. And their report said, more than 300 years ago, Lagos had a very sophisticated and advanced communication network, and that network was wireless. So, we said, if 300 years ago, Lagos had made such a leap to have an advanced wireless communication network, then back today in Lagos, it's possible to build an organization that will also make a leap in several different ways. So that's why SpringRock. And why SpringRock is to impact the status quo in such a measurable way that will ultimately result in a change of the status quo. Now, I'll give you two examples of where we've already done that. And as I go along, there'll be other examples that you pick up yourself that is slightly shifting the status quo, hopefully. Over time, we might see a change in the status quo. The first example lies in the area of trying to improve things that we already know. Now, today we have, not just in Nigeria, across the globe, you have organizations that refer to themselves as either project management companies or well management companies. Now, these companies, if you were to ask them, can you demonstrate to me your QAQC system? They might walk into your office with 40 different books. And they'll say, if you look in chapter 2 of this green one, you look in chapter 5 of the other one, if you look at the back page of this, you will find our QAQC systems. There's a problem with that. The problem with that is, with things scattered all over the place, you find out that those things are not religiously followed all the time. And what will ultimately happen is that there will be a failure in your website, and you receive a report that says, action item, we will enforce the use of our procedures. But you'll agree with me, that's a little too late for you. That the use of procedures will now be enforced after you've already suffered a loss. So what did SpringRock do? We put together a holistic and comprehensive QAQC process and procedure that actually spans the entire chain of oil well or oil and gas well construction in one document. And that way, we ensure that we are able to utilize that religiously every step of the way. And we actually have utilized that in a project that we worked on in 2016. The second example I'll give to you is in trying to look at things that are fairly new. One of the things that my colleague will discuss a little bit in detail, and as you see some of our banners, is we are going into research and development. We are not satisfied that majority of the solutions that is consumed in the oil and gas industry comes from somewhere else. And we believe that we have within Nigeria and within Africa, the strength in terms of human capability and the dexterity that it takes to be able to come up with new innovations. And as we speak, we already have an ongoing research and development on a particular subject, and my colleague will mention a little bit about that in detail. So, that's about why SpringRock. Of course, how and what, you'll agree with me, is a much longer story. If I go into those details, maybe we'll leave here tomorrow. So we will leave that for a more intimate one-on-one conversation, which we've already started with a number of your companies, which we are going to continue with all the other companies, and we'll demonstrate to you what and how, or if I flip it the other way, we'll demonstrate to you how and what. So also now, permit me to mention to you the various organizations that populate the SpringRock Group. We have six businesses. You can refer to them as six brothers or sisters or even cousins, as the case may be. We have SpringRock Energy. We have SpringRock M Consoles. We have SpringRock Alliance World. The SpringRock Gemini Resources, which is the group that we are launching this evening. We have SpringRock Crystal Industries, and then SpringRock EMP Investments. One thing that you see, by the time I give you a little bit of a flavor of what each of these organizations have been built to do is that we will have the length and breadth of capabilities that is required for development and production. So we actually refer to ourselves as a development and production company. Now, to go into why did we choose some of what we chose to do, we also look back a little bit, maybe 90 to 100 years ago, when your predecessors, who were called Wildcats, at that time, they had one major preoccupation, which was to tell what strata has a bit crossed. Does that strata contain anything? Is it oil? Is it water? Is it gas? That preoccupation led into an avalanche of development of gadgets. So over the years, so many gadgets were developed. So we believe that at least 95% of the gadgets required have already been built. So we chose that we were not going to go into the gadget business. There's enough gadget in the industry. However, where we see that there is work that we still need to be further done is how do you effectively integrate these gadgets, execute on time, execute within cost, and execute without hurting anybody. That, we feel, is a lot more important today than having any new gadgets in the industry. So for SpringRock Energy, we have two business areas. The first one is well construction, project management, and then drilling services. Now for us, when we say well construction, we don't start at when you're mobilizing the rig. We're actually looking at from when you acquire the asset. If there's already an FDP, maybe we relook at the FDP. If there's none, you need to develop one from scratch. And then you go through the entire chain of your well engineering. You dive into basis of design, and you do all the things that you need to do until you say, well, we are about to go into execution. We can put together, and we have done, about 40 to 50 plus services that you need in a well construction environment in a very breathtaking speed. Following that, we will manage the mobilization. Now, mobilization typically seems to be, let's just get the equipment and get it to the well site. Often, that is not enough. Because if we don't ensure that every element that we're getting to the well site is in a condition to deliver what it's supposed to deliver before it gets to the well site, then we have a problem. And quite often, we leave this to the persons who are providing it, which, yes, they are supposed to ensure that it is where it's supposed to be, and often it's not. So mobilization is a very critical part, and within the mobilization, we ensure that all the various PAQC is done. Then we look after the entire day-to-day execution. Now, we also know that sometimes we have great plans, and if you interrogate the plan is 100% perfect, but when you execute, things don't go quite well. So execution itself is very important, all the way until when we hand over production wells. In drilling, we actually currently have interest in a 300-foot jackup. The jackup is fully refurbished. It's sitting in South Africa on a warm stack. We are hoping that one of you will soon give us the opportunity to bring that rig into play here in Nigeria. Now, you notice that I talked about not having a gadget, and now I'm talking about a rig. So, the rig is the only gadget that we made an exception. And the reason, I'm sure, is very obvious to you. The rig is actually central to quite a number of activities that I'm going to describe here. And again, looking at the way we want to do things, we would like to see a scenario where we are delivering a well and the rig belongs to us. So that way we don't send you a report and say the drilling company did not do this and do that, that's why you're having a problem on your well site. So we feel comfortable that we can do all the chain and we don't have to point a finger at anybody. So that's why we made an exception for the drilling rigs. Moving on to SpringRock and Consult. M-Consults, I'll describe as a management group. We have the capability to provide technical management and leadership. We also have the capability to provide executive management. But something a little bit different here, you know, we see quite a number of scenarios where you have a management contract, but it actually needs one person is put in your organization and your company walks away. What we will do in our case is, if we put a person or persons in an organization, they will actually be backed with the length and breadth of the capability of our organization. So it's actually a company that's working for you and not for a single individual. In addition, we have three products that we offer under e-consults. The first is finance and executive, so that's a fairly straightforward one, where we want to align with asset owners like yourselves, and either we jointly or singly finance a project and execute the project alongside, of course, with the right economic framework. We have the SpringRock Gemini Suites. Now, the SpringRock Gemini Suites is our own name for what the industry used to call turnkey drilling. We remember that turnkey drilling was a fashion in the 90s, and then by the early 2000s, it died away. It might still be occurring here and there, but it's no longer something widely done. And there was a reason why turnkey drilling died. We spent time to study and come to understand what we believe is the reason why turnkey drilling died. And we believe that if you put the right framework in place, if you overcome the shortcomings the people who were doing turnkey drilling were doing in the 90s, then you'll be able to deliver turnkey drilling. So our drilling suites, it's a product that will hopefully come to agreement with you, and we say the well cost $10 million, and it will be $10 million and your well will be delivered. The last but not the least of the products is what we call ECW, which stands for Effective Cost of Wells. We've actually put together a process that is able to reduce the cost of drilling a well to as low as possible, but with one strong caveat, without compromising your objective. Now, I could chop off one or two of the objectives and I say I've saved money. That's not what we're talking about. Meeting all the objectives that were set by you at the time the agreement was made, and still delivering you the lowest possible cost. And just to tell you how confident we are with this product, it's a no gain, no pay. So if we set a benchmark, and at the end of the exercise, we do not deliver to you the savings we said we're going to deliver, you not pay for the savings. So moving on to Crystal Industries. Crystal Industries is a production outfit for SpringRock, and this group is looking at management of production operations for all its entirety. It's also looking at enhancement of production and optimizing wells depending on where what is the present condition of the well. Crystal Industries, similar to M-Consults, will also do finance and executive. Now, I wasn't trying to write an equation where I have E plus F plus M. I just don't have space to be able to write what they mean. So we will finance and execute jointly or singly production optimization, which is quite straightforward. But we're also looking at facilities. So quite often, in your business plan, you have so many other things that are chasing after the money you have, and you possibly would rather add more wells than to expand the facility. So we will come in and dialogue with you, and we'll bear the cost of the facility, and of course there will be a framework on how to share the benefits. And the M starts for maintenance. Again, a very similar story to maintenance. In prioritizing your budget, you may also share the maintenance, even though that is something that is quite critical. And you know, as we all know, in management there's no right or wrong. You have to make choices with what you have. So we are also looking at scenarios where we will finance a maintenance process with the right framework. The next business group is EMP Investments. So EMP Investments is an asset holding group of SpringRock. And the three assets we're interested in is what are called tiny little participation in equity, where it makes sense. And why do we want to do that? It's primarily because we believe that we have very good capability that we can team up with like-minded parties and be able to monetize assets to the most optimal way. The other thing that this will help us to do, hopefully, is to be our own guinea pigs. We talked about an ongoing R&D project. We've talked about a lot of new things that we are trying to do in the industry. And we want to be able to try that on ourselves, hopefully, before we take it to someone else. Of course, risks, I already mentioned earlier. And we also studying two key areas in manufacturing on that ERP investment. Alliance World, it's a group that I call our collaboration group. Now, if we look at how organizations have advanced in the past 20 years, some of the biggest organizations that exist today did not exist 20 years ago. And each one of them is one form of collaboration for another. So we also want to ensure that we don't try to do everything all on our own, we don't try to do everything from scratch, but we are able to go out and collaborate with their companies. We have a very extensive engagement that we believe in a few months from now, we'll be providing a solution for power in FPSOs. This is a proprietary system that we are working with the IP owner to hopefully deliver in Nigeria. In terms of equipment, we don't plan to sell equipment. There's nothing wrong with selling equipment. It's a good business. But we are looking at equipment to be able to tie that up as part of either a production enhancement or a construction of a facility or a well construction. So we have understanding with OEMs whom in such a scenario where the specifications meet will also provide us equipment along with our offering. And the last but not the least, we want to do joint operations. And we are not talking of doing joint operations with people who are outside our field. We are actually talking of joint operations with people whom you ordinarily would call our competition. And we believe that that's also a way that you can strengthen yourself. It's also a way you can spread your wings. We already talked to people. One of the parties, the first time we talked to them, they looked at us and said, "What are you talking about? You're my competition." We said, "So what? Why can't we find a way to work together if it makes sense?" So that's one of the things that we would like to do. The last of the business group is Gemini Resources, which is the group that brought us here this afternoon. But we also wanted to use the opportunity to talk to you a little bit about the other business groups. My colleague Kumar will spend quite a good amount of time to dive into what we are doing with Gemini Resources. So I'll leave that alone. But like I said earlier on, if I am going to dive into what and how, you could see quite a spread of activity. This will take us quite throughout the evening. So what and how as it's related to each of these business groups is something that will continue on a one-on-one discussion with your various companies. So I hope that I've been able to give you a little bit of an introduction of who we are and what we want to do. We will hopefully take this introduction into deep dive and have more discussions as we go along. And what we hope to do is to align with E&P operators in various manner. That way, we work side by side with you, and some of your battles we can fight alongside with you. I'm not saying for you, but alongside with you. And in various ways, whether it involves execution of projects, which we already engaged in that, or it's related to other areas, be them financing and executing of projects. Again, we can either do that jointly or we can do that singly. We also intend to move into areas associated with management of operations, so it could just be a single project, It could be development of capabilities or processes and procedures for your various organization. We are going to discuss with you how we intend to be able to hopefully take from you an engineer who's fresh from school, and 6 months later, hand back to you an engineer who has a capability that is equivalent to somebody who's been working for 2 to 3 years in the industry. And the next is production. As we all know that, at the end of the day, production is why we are in this business. So increasing production and extending the life of the asset is quite key. And the last, but I say one of the most important part is we want to contribute to new ideas in terms of technological development to the oil and gas industry. Of course, whatever we do, we'll start by using it here in Nigeria, and we'll also see how this will be adapted and be part of practices across the globe. So I hope I've been able to give you a flavor of who we are and what we aspire to be. I'm not by any means saying just because we said we're going to do this, we've done it. Some of them we have done, that's a fact. Some of them we are in the process of getting them to go. But we can't do it without your support. So part of coming to tell you what we do is also to plead for your support, so that you give us the opportunity to support and to serve. And lastly, I will leave you with a photograph. Now, when you look at this photograph, I'm sure there's so much interpretation that anybody can make out of this photograph. If I was to go around the room and say, what do you see? There'll be quite a number of opinions that come out of it. But what I'll say is, please feel free to interpret this photograph whichever way you want. But my only comment is, this photograph is a one-shot depiction of whom SpringRock is and what we want to be. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Absent. So we're going to move on. So tie all that has been said together, I want to show you a video. After that, there will be a presentation by Dr. Kumar. So we're going to take the time. It's a very short video. The title is together what has been said. I will also announce that there will be a time for questions and answers about what AK has presented and what Kumar is going to present later. I'm sure you are there already for that. Let me show you the video. Please enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you. face challenges all through the ages. We still do not know exactly how the ancient Egyptians built the pyramids. However, we know that to overcome the challenge they faced, they had to adapt and develop their talents. Human talent development is at the heart of not only building the pyramids and all the wonders the world has seen, it is also key in overcoming any obstacle. Our industry is facing several challenges related to harder to find oil and gas, sustaining for long, safe and cost-effective extraction of hydrocarbons, and many more other challenges. Human talent development remains at the heart of the solution. However, we need to develop our teams faster and put them to independent use in a much shorter time. Herein lies another need for change. Since the Industrial Revolution, technological advancement has transformed the way we live, work, and play. Technology and modern evolve in one form for a specific purpose. When these technologies are adapted, they can be applied to other uses. Talent development is at the heart of meeting the needs of the industry. However, we need to achieve independent domain expertise much faster than has been traditionally done. A new approach that can build only in 6 to 9 months capabilities that are normally attained in 2 to 3 years is here. Our applied technology domain seeks to utilize existing technology for new applications and solutions, in some cases, improve efficiency of existing solutions by making resources. We would pilot in Africa to move from a net consumer of new technology to a provider of new solutions and technology for the global oil and gas industry. We are pursuing new solutions along with new, innovative, and faster human talent development, and we will maintain a relentless effort in applied technology. SpringRock Gemini Resources. The future and solutions of tomorrow are here.
Hope you enjoy that. Where we digest it. We are going to move to the next item on the agenda. That's for the Chief Technology and Operating Officer. The SpringRock Group will come out to give a presentation on general resources and the talent drop. Thank you.
So we are standing before you now to introduce and present our model talent track, which is made on the dedicated efforts of highly specialized experts from global industry and for almost 1 year. As part of the expanding business, we thought competency development goes beyond that human talent development into R&D and new innovations and technology. So we thought about a mission development for especially specific to Nigeria. I don't want to read the whole thing, but what's important for us is to become a leader in human talent development and empowerment through application-oriented models and international standards. And also a leading innovator through applied technology research and development to develop new technologies in upstream oil and gas industry in Nigeria. As a vision, we want to be a preferred instrument and push the establishment to empower the Nigerian oil and gas industry and the local talent, in African talent, to world-class competency, and also to become a pioneer in Africa to export technology and solutions from being a net consumer, despite being a very important prominent oil exporting country in the world. So, with that aspect in mind, our portfolio is divided into three categories: talent development, applied technology, and R&D. In the talent development, we have competency development and knowledge enhancement. In the applied technology, applied and emerging technologies, research and development, and optimization and continuous improvement. And the R&D, new innovations and improvement of suboptimal solutions. So with this portfolio in mind, in order to accomplish and achieve the mission and vision statement, we know that we have to partner with variable and appropriate companies across the world. So we established value-based strategy partnership, and the partnership was designed to provide the world-class expertise together in Gemini, in one place in Nigeria, so that the local talent is empowered. Through application-oriented training models, research and development of technology and practices, optimal solutions for industry technical and operational problems, and develop expertise within the country to export technology and solutions. Now, with this, we just want to introduce our partners here. Gemini Resources, with IWELS Management Consultancy Dubai, is the main partner and talent track IP owner, technical management, and research and intellectual property. With this, with academic universities across the globe, we have academic and competency kind of cooperation. And with the oil and gas operating companies and service providers, we have R&D and new solutions and technology solutions for the industry. In addition to that, we have a collaboration with a company called RigTech. It's a well operations HSC management training center in India. And this is our facility there in India. It's got a drilling rig. We also have a hoist. And this is the Gemini IWELS rig infrastructure. And a full-fledged drilling cabinets. It's very, all the aspects of drilling is there, starting from, we also have a 400 feet of well, a casing is there where people can run drill strings and drill there. We also have a BOP, we have a facility to inject nitrogen gas as an influx, that people can really practically understand what is well controlled beyond an IWCF, beyond classroom training. A similar model is planned by Gemini in Nigeria by end of 2018. So before we go forward, I would like to take a few minutes to discuss, because you might have seen a lot of presentations from many companies, and people come and give different presentations, different ideas and concepts. But what is typical is that, what is the difference between a knowledge enhancement, a training, and competency development? Why Gemini Resources is importing on competency development as a major model? Any industry, whether it is a process industry, or oil and gas, or any industry, requires a predictable, sustained, continuous quality performance. But that comes only from three major factors. One is uniformity, consistency, and reliability. In any industry, whether it's McDonald's, or Starbucks, or Apple, or Windows, anything. But the process and manufacturing plants, or factories, all over the world, have demonstrated a very high percentage of success. We don't hear a major problem in a process industry or a petrochemical plant or a refinery. But in the oil and gas industry, that scalable model throughout the globe, it doesn't exist. Even after so many years of advances in technology and the models, even today all across the world, somewhere, at some place, a simple vertical 2000 meter well cannot be drilled without any problem. For example, as a statistical model, all over the world, at least 30% of the wells have some kind of a problem. Out of that, about 10% of the wells get into major issues, and about 3% of the wells have been lost or getting sidetracked even today after 60 years of advancement. That you don't see in the process industries or refining or petrochemical industries. Last year, because normally about 60,000 wells are drilled all across the world. Last year, because our oil prices were low, about 40 to 42,000 wells have been drilled. 3% of the wells have been lost or sidetracked. It's a huge amount for an industry which is advancing for the last 60 years. So, what I would like to bring in is here, what is the challenge? Why this is happening? Why we are not able to achieve a scalable, global model? The most important thing here is the scalability. When I say scalability, the consistency, uniformity, or reliability has to be scaled where, whether you are in Nigeria, or in India, or Bangladesh, Middle East, USA, or Europe. It doesn't happen in oil and gas industry. For example, Starbucks or McDonald's have more than 10,000 branches or franchises all across the world. And everywhere the same reliability and consistency is maintained. Whether you're having a cup of coffee of Starbucks in the US, or you're having it in Nigeria, or somewhere in the Middle East, you'll have the same taste. Same thing happens to McDonald's. But you cannot do that with the same thing. Whether a company like Choda in Japan, for example, which is implanting a lot of refinery plants across the world, whether they do it in Qatar or Saudi Arabia or anywhere else, all the refinery plants exactly work for 24 years without any trouble, as long as it's properly maintained. So, whether it's a process industry or a food industry, this scalability is achieved by these two companies. In upstream oil and gas, you cannot do this scalability, mainly because of in the other industries, the human intervention and the human attention is far, far less compared to oil and gas industry. In every industry, they are highly automated and is process oriented. But in the case of the non-scalable industry, like oil industry, it is not practically possible because it's already been discussed. I just go to the next slide. What is important, if you look at the well construction, subsurface, well construction and projects, they cannot be scalable because even today with all the advancements in technology for seismic acquisition, seismic interpretation, well planning softwares, everything, despite all these things, they completely involve human intervention. Human attention is required. Because if you keep two geologists here in the table and give them the same maps, same seismic, they will come up with two different analogy and concept for drilling exploration wells or even development wells. Same thing happens with two senior drilling engineers, you put them across the table, give them the same data, they'll come with two different types of drilling at the same well. So it is actually have a lot of human intervention. The success of any project in oil and gas, it is because of the talent and the competency of the people who are drilling. In other cases, in process industry, the competency is not required. Anybody can work in a McDonald's or Starbucks with minimum training, minimum exposure. You don't require a huge amount of competency for running a McDonald's or a Starbucks or a process industry, petrochemical industry. So, normally humans are not scalable at all. We have our energy which is restricted and we have a constraint. That's another problem. And so, in human intervention, beyond that oil and gas industry, all of you know very well, being the industry leaders, it requires a very logical, compliant and prudent approach in oil and gas industry. That cannot be scalable by just process and by automation alone. So it requires the intervention of the human attention. In addition to all these things, most important in oil and gas is that every operator is different. Operating companies do not benchmark their performance against each other. They may benchmark, there are Rushmore benchmarks and IRDH benchmarks across the world, but they only benchmark the kind of a course output, like cost of a well, production capacity, how they deal, but not the intrinsic value of how to deliver well. Also, they do not share the experience intrinsically. There are a lot of SPE conferences, other kind of forums, where the operators people come and kind of discuss and expose whatever they've done, but always talk about the success stories. But they do not share their experience intrinsically with other companies. And initially, the operators do not compete with each other. That's the most important thing. They do not compete like Apple or Samsung or a Mac and Windows or Android or iOS. Whatever you have, they don't have a competition against the other operators. Service companies like Halliburton, Schlumberger, Baker, they compete with each other on technology, services and kind of models. But the most important thing is that it's very critical to understand, despite they compete against each other, every operator is a client, not a customer. There's a lot of difference being a customer and a client. In a process industry like refining, I'm going to buy a finished product, a petrol or gasoline or diesel, I am a consumer. If I don't like the petrol here, I can go somewhere else. But in the oil and gas industry, despite Halliburton, Schlumberger, Baker, the biggest, they compete with each other, they develop technology, they put services, they do not give the finished product. Because oil and gas companies, when they're operating, the operator has got his own team and he manages his operations, and the other building, the service companies are giving services. A simple example, somebody that uses cementing services, it's not a finished product. There is somebody has to run the casing, somebody has to circulate the mud to condition the hole, then cementing has to be done, and cementing has to be designed by a well engineer. So it's a combination of several people. Somebody alone cannot give a finished product. Since we don't have a finished product, in this model, the service company, despite whatever they do, it cannot be scalable. That is a major concept in every... So all of you have seen this. This is very famous from 1960s. Nothing much changed here. But from a competency point of view, there are four major stages. First one is the unconscious incompetence. All of you know about it. Second is the conscious incompetence. Then third one is the conscious competence, and fourth, unconscious competence. But I would like to go through one by one here. What is unconscious incompetence? It is basically what happens here is the wrong intuition. This is the most dangerous out of all the competent model. Most of the projects in the world, you see the failure cases, if you analyze them, 70% of them has been failed only because of unconscious incompetence. Unconscious incompetence is people working for the project, they do not know that they don't know the job. They assume that they know the job. They kind of conform and guarantee with the management, I know the job, I will do it. They are very much afraid to go to the management that I don't know this, please, I'll take external help. They are very much afraid to say so. Because of their own career growth, own position, they kind of think and assume they know the job. So they try to do the job and they end up in trouble. And this is the most dangerous for any organization to have. And second one is the conscious incompetence. This is a better one compared to this one, but still the people know that they are incompetent or something is going wrong, it is not the right thing to do. But despite knowing that, they may escalate to the next level or they may not escalate. If you look at the case of Mekando incident, it is exactly based on the conscious incompetence. Whatever decision taken by the supervisors on the Mekando well on 20th of April 2010, it was purely based on conscious incompetence. If you look at all the major blowers in the world, the last 40-50 years, there are 28 major blowers in the world. Or 28 major blowers, if you look at all the analysis of that, 70% of them has occurred because of conscious incompetence. And the remaining 30% occurred because of the unconscious incompetence. So with these two models, the most important is any training, any kind of knowledge enhancement does not teach this kind of things to the people. The most important for competence development to bring the people to the conscious competence level, to do the right analysis, and then unconscious competence. The unconscious competence is basically what does it do that unconsciously you are very much competent. Even at midnight, you are sleeping very sound. Somebody wakes you up, someone tells you about a problem on the well, they are able to immediately come back and find out solutions for that. They are unconsciously very competent of what is happening around. That is the topmost level. If any organization having a team of people between the unconscious competence and conscious competence, every project will go well. Some of the greatest examples are Murphy Oil. Murphy Oil, all of you know about it. They never went to the onshore, offshore, shallow offshore to gain experience. Straight away, they went to the deep water. And then even today, they're one of the best companies in the world who run deep water operations. Small companies are very efficient. Second major company you can talk about is Unocal. It's one of the major companies. Many people in the industry know about Unocal. They can drill a 3,000 meter well and complete it in 6 days. Nobody has achieved that. Just for information, I was in Nepal for 2 to 3 weeks in Bangkok. There were headquarters trying to learn what they are doing. And in 2008-2009, I don't know exact the year, Chevron purchased the company in Nepal. All the exporters in Nepal went out. But when Nepal was drilling the wells in 6 days, drilling and completing, and Chevron drilled the first one in 39 days. Even today, after 7 years, Chevron has achieved only up to 12 days. They are doing very good, but Chevron is excellent. It's a big company worldwide. They have a fantastic company. But the Unocal achievement is still unbeaten. The idea is that the entire organization is completely filled with the top 2 level of people. Competency in today's world, what is competency? Competency is just not like a talent or knowledge. It is a cluster of several things. The first cluster is the integrated abilities and the committed focus, appropriate skills, attributes to adapt, and domain knowledge. The adaptability and the domain knowledge is very critical for competence. In addition to that, people have to have integrated ability to integrate things when they look at it. If you look at the 3 domains of learning, which was developed in 1956 and 1972 by Bloom's taxonomy, it says very clearly the 3 domains of learning are basically cognitive, affective, and integrative, and psychometric. And these are developed very heavily into the industry system now and moved into select, organized, integrated models. Basically, competency comes into this learning system and teaching systems where you have to develop ability of the people through this combined model. So when you train someone to develop competency, not talent, not knowledge enhancement, then they achieve to act efficiently, effectively, and in a job in a wide variety of situations. Most of the traditional training models, what we have, they train the people for a compartmentalized, a single way of working. And when your situation changes, circumstances changes, they should be able to manage and participate and execute properly. So what are the existing training models in the industry? There are 3 major models in the industry today. The first one is the traditional or conventional, where the freshers or engineers or beginners are actually are put under a supervisor or in the office or the field or combined as a traditional model. It takes about 2 to 3 years to bring a competency for them in the respective positions, mainly because of 2 things. The training method is limited by the supervisor's boundary conditions and also limitations of the jobs assigned to them. Simple example for him to take it over, a drilling supervisor is assigned to a training. So the drilling supervisor job is only to make sure that the well operations are run safely and smoothly as per the drilling program. He does not have the time beyond that to teach a training any fundamental concept, basic principles. He will teach him how to manage, how to do that, and assign some jobs to him. That jobs are kind of limited jobs for the trainee to do it, because the drilling supervisor, he is not going to take the risk of putting his own job in trouble by giving opportunity for the youngster who is joining him. I was a trainee once upon a time. I was put under a drilling supervisor. I was put under senior drilling engineers, and I know how much I learned from it. It took a long time to come out of it and learn things properly, very effectively. And so the traditional model takes about 2 to 3 years to do that. The second model is the knowledge enhancement training model. All of us might have attempted this. Many training models are 2 to 3 days, 3 days, 5 days of training models available in the industry. Some of them go for 2 to 4 weeks. And the mostly designed, because the time is limited, short time people have to be taught in 3 to 5 days, they are based on practices in design as well as operations. They do not talk about the fundamental basic concepts. So it helps to enhance the knowledge, but if not applied practically in the field, it's not going to be useful. It's going to fade out at some point of time. And another major issue in the knowledge system is that there is no sustainable follow-up and it's very expensive. The third system is the statutory and compliance. All of us know about it. And like IWCF or WellCap or any kind of first aid or any kind of thing. People actually, what they do is the certificate courses. Primary purpose of this one is to get a certificate which is valid. That's what people do. And here, the biggest issue is there's no competence-based training. If you go to an IWCF or a WellCap training course, you can see a drilling manager of 30 years of experience when you're sitting with the assistant driller of a rig on the same class. The teacher who is teaching them, he cannot go beyond the level of the assistant driller who came from the rig, who knows only operations, how to control BOP, how to open and close the BOP. The drilling manager is designing the entire well control operations from design as well as execution. They both of them to sit together in the class. So there's no competency-based one. Because of this, with the time available, they have to train the system within the syllabus, within the time. There is no interactive deliberations or intellectual communications between the teacher and the students. So most of the statutory complaints, the basic fundamental principle is to teach you to act the first line of action. If there is a reflux in the well, all the trainees will know how to shut the well, shut the close the BOP. After that, they are not allowed to even do anything to control the system. The well drilling procedure is managed by very experienced two or three people. All these people, irrespective of whether they have IWCF or well cap, they won't be even allowed to touch any of the operations. Only two or three people of highly experienced people will do that. So the training is only to act the first line of action. So oil and gas companies are service providers. Basically what happens, they spend to train someone significant time, cost, energy and money. And especially the low oil prices, it's important that every company is looking for a high talent, competent and skilled engineers. That's what is important for the industry today, who can work independently with minimum supervision and minimum training. In effect, the industry needs a system which will allow people to be having a good domain knowledge. They are employable, they are deployable, and they are adaptable. The adaptability and deployability becomes a very important criteria in the current oil and gas market conditions, because companies want people to multitask. In the olden days, I remember in early 1990s when I was working on it, there were used to be 14 different departments, starting from subsurface, geology, geophysics, reservoir engineering, drilling, testing, completion, contracts, procurement, project, facilities, production, everything all together. There were 14 or 15 departments. When you are working in a drilling department, you will be there for next 10 years. You only know drilling, you don't know anything about testing and completion. Testing is a separate department, completion is a separate department. So you have expert for everything. But Shell got and BP got the drilling in the 90s concept when they brought into a synergy of only three major divisions, which are subsurface, well construction and logistics facilities. Now these 14 departments were coming to three departments and they worked under a single head for each department. And now, then the multitasking adaptability came into the picture. Late 2000, they wanted to do it, but unfortunately from 2004 to 2014, oil prices were running $100 a barrel, every company was making good profit. The optimization model kind of went to a different model altogether. But then with oil prices dropped down, people realized, every service company, the standardizer, Adamson or Baker, or every operator realized that multitasking, highly able, adaptable, deployable engineers makes the project successful and reduces the cost. So, most importantly, all this thing has to be inculcated in a very short time. Traditionally, it takes about 2 to 3 years, but can reduce this time. So, that's what Talent Track is coming, where you can do it in 6 to 9 months' time. Talent Track is the intellectual property of IOS Dubai, and Gemini Resources is an independent company on its own, developed a training and solutions model, and then we decided that, okay, we can join with IOS to develop IOS in the Africa region. So it is designed to address all the traditional and conventional models, the issues of that, and also the competency of the individual to develop such a way that we can be deployed with the minimum supervision, and we can work on a, last line is very important, at the conscious competence level. You'll be moved out of the unconscious incompetence and conscious incompetence level to the third one, which is the conscious competence level. So how does Talent Track model? Now I talked about the various shortcomings and what is happening, difference between training and talent and competency. A question may come to your mind that how we are going to achieve that. So we are using two things purposefully. One is the law of effectiveness and second is law of principles. And through 7 application-oriented principles. So an individual can be able to achieve competence and use his expected positions using these principles. And if you look at the law of effectiveness, simply I don't want to go through the slides, but simply to explain what is law of effectiveness. There may be thousands of methods to do something. Anything you look at it, there will be 1,000 methods can do that. Yeah, people can do it different methods. But the fundamental rules governing those all particular activity will be very, very few. For any activity, they have millions of ways of doing things, but the fundamental rules will be very few. So if someone grabs the principles and the strategy, fundamental rules and fundamental laws, then you'll be able to devise his own methods, own ideas, strategies to execute that particular job. If not, people will go different methods and ineffective, inconsistent, and require a long time to understand which is the most appropriate model. And most importantly, if the circumstances change, then they'll have to find a new way of doing things. So, if someone grasps the principles and the fundamental laws, you'll be very efficient, you'll have a quality in delivery, excellent consistency, and without time consuming learning curves. The most important thing for any oil and gas operator is, guys, we have to reduce the learning curve. The learning curve is high in any new project that's going to take a lot of money, a lot of cost. The world's highest learning curve cost, before even CRISPR cost, is about $200 million. I don't know the name of the operator. $200 million was spent as a CRISPR cost, highest in the world. And it is not uncommon that operators spend varying between $20 million to $50 million as a CRISPR cost because of long learning curves. So that can be avoided, and cost optimization, efficiency and consistency delivery can come in if everybody is trained to become the conscious competence level. So you can apply for freshers and beginners, even for very experienced people. That's why we have level 1 for beginners and freshers, level 2 for experienced people, and level 3 for people who are domain experts. So law of principles basically works on three paradigms. The first one is the fundamental law that obeys the natural laws. Whatever you do in life, there are fundamental physical laws, nobody can change it. For example, gravity. Things will fall if you drop it. It's not going to go above, and then there's a force to overcome the gravity. There are some fundamental laws people have to learn from the first principles. The second is integrity in design, operations, and execution. What is important here, the integrity is, there's a very minimum margin for any kind of compromise in integrity in design. The second, the last one is the effective strategy without manipulative exploitation. It's a very important word. When I say manipulative, it looks kind of a bad word. When I say manipulative, it's not manipulating something. It's to execute a job, trying to be efficient. But this will allow someone to compromise certain laws. That will lead to problems in the integrity of the well. Problems in the well, it's not uncommon to see that people, Mekando is the greatest example of manipulative exploitation. And if you take up a complete reading over the what is the finding of Mekando incident, it was purely because of conscious incompetence and manipulative exploitation. Knowingly, they made a kind of approach, that's what all the problems happen. 5 million barrels of oil in the Gulf and all kinds of issues. So what are 7 principles of operating wisdom? It's not only now, it's been here for thousands of years in the world, not new to us, but it is coming different names. The first one is the strong fundamentals, as we discussed. Second is the precise knowledge. Third is the acquired wisdom. Without the strong fundamentals and precise knowledge, nobody can acquire wisdom. And next is the effective strategy, automatically follows the wisdom and the business philosophy, smart applications, and efficient execution. These 7 models are very critical for anybody to develop a company. Again, as said earlier, it's not only applicable for fresh and beginners, it's also applicable for very experienced domain experts. For 30 to 40 years of experience. When something changes, when a new model comes in, they have to apply all these models to develop a new project and execute it. So the efforts actually to work effectively with a scalability model and uniformity consistency. This is what everybody wants to achieve. Every company dreams to achieve these 3 things. My project team has to have uniformity, consistency and reliability. Every owner of the asset, every operating oil and gas companies, every service provider, every company actually dreams to have a team like that. So what is the talent track model? Basically it was developed by highly experienced industry experts who are still active in place. Many of the training models around the world, even if you go to very famous and popular training companies like OGCI or Prentice in the USA, you go there, you look at the trainers, they are very dead. They may be young people about 45, 50 years old, but they don't want to go back to the industry. They return from the industry and they become trainers. They are not active in service. Very, very few trainers become active in service. And so because of that, they are going to hear actually everybody is still active in service. They are executing the jobs in their respective positions. I got a highly practical application-oriented approach. Because these people are still active in service, they are able to introduce and bring in latest technology, latest applications, latest practices. Like all of you know, API, after the Mekando incident, changed all the API standards in 2012. And then most of the API standards are moved into ISO, because API said certain things ISO has to handle. So, ISO has gone to ISO. Then also people have moved from a normal deterministic model into a probabilistic model. So new technology has come into that. So all this happened in 2012. But what is happening here is, if I can tell you very clearly, many of the training institutions running from, say, 15, 20 years back, they are not having time to change the training models based on the new latest API, ISO and probabilistic models. The important point is, since everybody, the experts involved in talent track are still active in service, they are following the latest technology, they got the latest technology into the system. It also designed to provide holistic knowledge from scientific and conceptual perspective. And this is a very important point. There are two important points I told you about traditional and conventional training model. It takes about 2 to 3 years. This particular aspect of strategic and conceptual perspective will remove that particular problem. What is strategic and conceptual perspective? Basically, what is happening is that training, whether it's a fresher or an experienced person, understand the, from the concept stage, all the strategies are fundamental laws. So he is not driven by a particular compartmentalized work. Okay, go and do, look at it. Go to next year, 1 month, you just work on this different BHA, or just do what is happening on the rig and go to the rig and work as a well-centered rig engineer, or work with a mud engineer to run mud for about 2 months. So doing that, he understands the concepts and strategies and fundamental laws. A nice important point to eliminate the knowledge-based training for short term, and it is done by the sequential model, elaborating the elements that affect the sequence. This is a very important point actually, for every one of you, from the time you have an asset, and you have to develop the asset and monetize the asset by bringing commercial production. All of you know that it takes from anywhere between 4 to 7 years, even 10 years for some companies. Now it's a long time for investment to wait to monetize. And the most important thing for any project is not only for drilling, even for entire asset development, from the time you have an asset, you want to look at an exploration prospect, from there all the way down to appraisal and then field development plan, developing the well, putting the projects in place and commercial production. It's a whole process of 4 to 7 years, even 10 years for some companies. And this is a big sequence. Out of that, if you look at the well construction, it's the most difficult. More than 60 to 70% of the cost of any project goes to building a well. And if anything goes wrong, that a lot of money is lost by the company. So the sequence is ordered from the time the concept of drilling starts until the well is drilled and delivered. Every aspect of the sequential model is trained for the freshers, and they go through the learning process of every element that is affecting the sequence. So that removes the knowledge-based training for short term. So now a question may arise from your hands that, okay, you talk about all these things, what did you benchmark about existing training? There are a lot of competency models in the world. You go to Google and type competency model for well engineers, competency model for production engineers, you will see a lot of things coming out of the Google. But the most important ones, the first one everybody talks about, and then this is SPE has got a certification model for petroleum engineers. That's the most common, you can easily find it. Second is the Shell Long Run Round, is very famous. UP has got its own model, high value drilling. ExxonMobil has got its own model for InnoStar. And then there's another one from several companies, the Rig Management Competency Model. And this is a very famous one. Like the SPE, IADC has got an offshore competency model. So if you go to Google and type offshore competency, it will just fall in IADC and SPE. And people always talk about, oh, we have a very good competency model. And third one is, last one, there's several independent well engineers competency models across the world. So you want to benchmark calendar against each of them. The first one, what you do with the SPE certification. Now, talent track simply surpasses the SPE certification in all levels, and it is at least 2 to 3 times higher than the SPE certification requirement. So somebody having a talent track certificate course will be higher than the SPE certification course requirements. And Shell Round 1, Round 2 is very famous in the world. In Shell, for example, working in Shell, unless you pass Round 1 and Round 2, you cannot elevate yourself or get promoted to a particular position. Shell Round 1, Round 2 is based on knowledge development and people's knowledge. If somebody is knowledgeable enough, he can pass Round 1 and Round 2 very fast and move forward. Doesn't mean that it develops competence. It's a very good model, very famous. So here it is similar in the standard talent track, but differs in the approach. Shell is designed only for the in-house staff. It's not available for third party and commercial model. And whereas talent track is a universal model. So talent is sequential and imparts knowledge from conceptual approach to strategic and domain expert level, open to the industry across the globe. So it is actually kind of an overall model. And third one is the rig manager competency training. Now, talent track is for well construction from an operator's perspective, not from a drilling contractor's perspective. At this point of time, talent track is designed as an operator's perspective model, not from drilling contractor. But whereas the rig manager competency training is all for the drilling contractor's perspective. But we are now Gemini is trying to do that in sometime in Q2, Q3 2018. Excellence is also competency of IADC, is a very important, but if you look at all the IADC competency model, it is for only working on the rig, safe working on the rig, how to operate in offshore rig, how to operate in onshore rig. They do not have a well construction model competency like what talent flag has got. The talent flag is a completely well construction development model from operator side, not offshore working model. Last one is that there are a lot of various competency training programs across the world, but they are designed as a training model for gaining knowledge, not as a competency development model. So talent flag is different from all these things. So we have done all the benchmarking. Somebody is interested in so very detailed analysis of each and every training model and how talent flag is different from each of them. So what is the level actually? So we have three levels. Basically what we do is, I don't want to run through it, I'll just go through fast. We have an introduction to well construction, basically explaining what is well construction, what are the logical sequence to construct your well, and what are the requirements to construct your well. This is the first step from a sequential model to piece of paper. Second, we go into elements of well engineering. So the 20 elements of well engineering are there. It is a very sequential process. It goes one by one. And a good well engineer cannot bypass a single step. If you bypass one particular step, you won't be able to effectively do the well design for other steps. So at the end of the 20 steps, the trainee will be able to design your well practically along with this initial engineering. And then there's a well operations model. From the well design, we have to go to drilling program and execution model. The difference between well design and well program is well design talks about why we are drilling the well in the way we are explaining. Why the casing design is like this, why the mud plan is like this, why the cementing plan is like that, that's what well design talks about. But the drilling program talks about how to drill the well, step-by-step procedures for the drilling support. So we have this model for well operations and ending up with the daily field reports, and finally you can see end of the well. So basically this entire model starts from the initial concept of how to design a well all the way down to drilling a well and end of the well. So there are a total of 36 elements are there. 20 elements in the well engineering and 60 elements in the well operations. Well covered systematically and sequentially. And then the course duration is about 6 months for regular people and 9 months for non-regular. Non-regular, what I mean is somebody will be working in a company, they won't be able to come for 4 days a week. So they will be able to come only 2 days a week, we give them time. Or somebody may be working in the field on-off schedule. They may be in the field for 3 weeks and they have 3 weeks off. So we give them time to do that. So instead of 9 months for non-regular people. And the course model is something very interesting. It's about a coaching, direct, in-line on class and online, interactive e-learning, through webinars, mini projects. It's very important here the difference between knowledge training. Knowledge training, if you don't attend it, they will teach you, that's all. It's up to you whether you are learning or following up or doing things here. If you are teaching here, then we do a mini project. Then there will be a test for every module. Not a university exam. Like IWCF, you go there, unless you score 96% in IWCF, you are not very good well control engineer. Somebody can pass with 60-70%, but he is not a very good engineer. So IWCF put 70% as a pass mark, but the universities have 40% pass mark. Here we have put 85% as a pass mark for people to go to the next module when they are writing the exams. And the final project will be an actual project. We will be working with a very senior drilling engineer or a well engineer very closely for some time, develop a final project, practical project which is running in the industry. And then the final certificate exam is very tough, and people only with the right competency can pass the exam. It's not given for people just to have a certificate and walk around like a statutory approvals. Here is a competency model, people have to pass the exam with full competency knowledge. And then finally it is flexible and customized, and if any corporate wants to do that, they have a minimum of 5 trainees who can customize the entire model for them. So this is the, with this actually you can see the difference of what we are trying to achieve in talent track as compared to the traditional training models in the industry, and with that we are very confident that within 6 to 9 months we will be able to deliver a complete competency for a drilling engineer or a well engineer to operate with minimum supervision in the industry. So well construction is well engineering, well everything. We have already launched for beginners in 12th of April. We already have six trainees working with us on that. And then level 2 for experienced people is going to be launched on 14th of August 17th. And we are level 3 for domain expert by October sometime. And then the second model from well construction we discussed about it. The most important thing, which is you do not find a lot of training in the industry. There are some trainings given by OGCI or Prentice Hall. Some companies have a 5-day course is for drilling project management and well delivery. And well delivery is up to today. Again, the scenario has changed. Before, people talk about well construction, building of a well, testing and completely. Today, everybody talks about well delivery. Well delivery does not just end with just drilling a well. It actually has to meet all the objectives of from the corporate level expectations all the way down to the final completion and production objectives. So well delivery is it's a bigger term for well construction. So well delivery, project management and project execution are not easily available in the industry. So we're developing a computed model that will be launched the same level, three levels, sometime in 2017, different timelines. And beyond that, we might expand by end of this year or early next year to the Africa and Sub-Saharan region. So beyond that, this is only about competency development for well construction and building project management. But at the end of the day, Gemini Resources want to be a full-fledged training institute covering up every aspect of the oil and gas industry. So our idea is to develop into all the aspects of subsurface, then well construction, then production projects, then all others including HSC and building management. As I said, a complete setup of the rig is going to be done next year, 2018, and we'll also bring it a complete model. So it will be a full-fledged in the institute in Nigeria in all aspects. Actually, it's very rare to see such kind of a full-fledged institute across the world. A lot of places we have training institutes only for subsurface, only for drilling, only for production. We are going to bring everything together here. So this is the every training will be following the same model of effectiveness and principles. Phase one is going to be drilling before the end of this year, and phase two will be including the production facilities by early 2018, and phase three by all subsurface before 2018. By end of 2018, we'll have a full-fledged training model in Nigeria. So in addition to that, we've been discussing about only training, so talent, competency, what else we can do. As one of the mission and vision statement what we talked about, how to empower the local talent into something bigger than training. So we look at the research and development as a model. If you look at it, we have seen that with abundance of human talent in Africa, especially in Nigeria, and we have seen a lot of Nigerians, not only in Nigeria itself, outside Nigeria occupying very senior positions, including institutions like NASA. So when there are so many powerful, intellectual, highly senior positions of Nigerians outside India, outside Nigeria, why they cannot develop innovative technologies within the country? That's the model came into the picture. So we talked to a lot of like-minded, highly intellectual Nigerians who are living outside Nigeria. Can they help us with their knowledge and competency and intellectuality to develop R&D? They are great for that. But the issue right now is the limited or weak focus in the universities to pursue innovations. The German Resources has decided to invest money on its own to fund R&D projects in Nigeria with the help of academic institutions across the world. So, the first one, we are focusing on well construction optimization and enhancement of recovery. And R&D is going to be a very practical approach. We are going to identify industry-wide problems and talk to the oil and gas operators and develop a R&D model to universities and research. So one example of industry-wide problem is that all of us know the industry again is drilling for so many years, but you'll be surprised to see in the Gulf of Mexico, more than 30% of the wells have annular pressure buildup. That means the completions are not having the integrity. In Gulf of Mexico, in GOM, 30% of the wells have annular pressure buildup issues. And out of the 30% wells, at least 30% of the wells are shut down because they can't produce. All over the world, annular pressure buildup is a major issue which cannot be resolved permanently. Big companies like Schlumberger and Halliburton are doing a lot of research to do different models of how to do it. In Nigeria also annular pressure buildup issues are there, but the advantage here is that most of the wells drilled in Nigeria are normal pressure wells. So pressure declines after initial production, so there is no major issue with respect to the pressure in Nigeria. But if you go outside Nigeria, places around annular pressure buildup and high pressure wells, especially gas wells, are very, very high. Now Nigeria is entering into the gas development now. When they won't enter into gas development, some of the wells are having huge thick 200 feet or 300 feet of gas column, and they want to drill deviated wells of 600, exposing some 700 to 800 feet of gas column, and they want to put that wells on production. These gas wells are going to create annular pressure buildup problem. Oil wells, medium pore pressure, more normal pore pressure, not an issue. So Nigeria requires an understanding of APB. So we are kind of developing a model for annular pressure buildup, not only in Nigeria, also to export the technology outside the world. So we identified two critical research and development projects. And the decision made by Gemini Research to invest money on that on its own without expecting any funding from operating oil and gas companies or service providers to start with. And all these services, the one is already commissioned in India in December 2016, second one is going to be commissioned in August 17 in Nigeria. And also by end of 2017, we'll be targeting for at least 4 R&D projects running simultaneously. And more importantly, we are going to kind of multitask. The same project will be run at different locations so that we can speed up and expedite, also develop technology faster. So in the R&D, the concept is basically to focus on the Nigerian oil and gas industry. And then after that, we also going into publications of books and keeping a diary. Now, these are normal textbooks. They're totally different from the normal books, what is available in the industry. Like you can go to Google or OGCI or IADC or SPE, you can download a lot of books. But there are books. They are written by experienced engineers and all. It's all, I would say, up to us how to use it. If you buy a book of advanced well control and advanced well engineering, advanced production technology, the book is having a lot of information written by a very experienced person. Now, it is only up to the individual how to use the book, how to apply for it. So the books we are developing is in a different model. It's a simple example of a book. This model of the book is a highly practical, workshop-oriented book. It's already ready to go. The next 2 or 3 months, the first book will be published. And if you look at the book, when it comes to your hand, you will see that it's a totally different type of book. It will make you to work towards it. It will make you to work and understand. The engineers can actually have a very happy go with the book. And second is a technical diary, which we're planning to release the first diary in 2018. And the model is given here. And finally, to conclude, we also will be running 2 seminars in a year. 2-day workshop and seminars on a particular industry topic. And second one, the first one is planned in August 17. And second one is the industry-wide seminar for industry on particular theme. Now, in Nigeria, we have seen that a lot of forums like SPE or some other forums are happening. But what we are trying to do is something different, a very value-based, value-added a seminar on a particular industry topic or a workshop on an industry theme. A theme is different from a topic. Topic is about one particular topic of the industry. A theme is we'll take up a full concept of cost optimization or risk management or insurance or liabilities or asset development, asset management, some concept, and it's a theme running for a day or 2 as a workshop. This is what the first one is done in October 2017. So what is our ambition and goal? Finally, to close it out, we have launched our strategy for accelerated development of Nigerian talent with the concept of importing knowledge as a competency development. So Nigeria's technical human capital is utilized as required, and applied technology, we already discussed a lot about that, and Nigerian content to support the ongoing efforts of the Nigerian government through Nigerian Content Board to develop Nigerian local talent and services. So the request to all the industry leaders, all of you are here after this presentation, is that we sincerely request all of you to support Gemini Resources for the effort we are taking to grow and enhance and elevate the Nigerian talent to competency level, and also to export the technology and innovations to outside Nigeria. Nigeria has been a consumer of this technology despite being an oil exporter for a long time, and one of the prominent oil exporters. And without your support, you won't be able to do it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kumar. I'm sure you have a lot of questions on Kumar's presentation and also on the presentation made by Eke. So, it's question and answers time. Anybody has it? Question, please indicate, and then the microphone will come to you. It may also be a comment and advice for us. It's not allowed. So we have 2 hands. So I'll go first come.
Yeah, really. question is just to, well, you talk about your training, you're going to develop young graduates in 6 weeks.
6 months.
Six months. I see from the analysis I have the final project. So I wanted to see where that comes in. Is it within the 6 months or after the 6 months?
Within the 6 9 months.
Within the 6 9 months.
It'll be part of the ongoing process.
Okay, thank you. Good evening, everybody. I'm
impressed but not surprised that I'm asking what it's doing. I'm not trying to. But let me just ask, the talent track, has it been practiced somewhere else by SpringRock, or is it a new system for you as a company? And the reason why I'm asking is, a lot of small companies don't want to be doing this. You can take Shell and Chevron and use them for 3 years and they are guinea pigs. For small companies of our size, want to try what has been tried and tested. I'd just like to know from Mark whether the talent track has been tried and tested here in Nigeria, elsewhere, and by SpringRock. Thank you.
It's a very question, very good question, sir. Talent track in Nigeria is tried for the first time, and this is a new system. We started developing the system about 2 years back, and it's attempted in India with seven freshers. We're ongoing this now, and the first batch will be completing in about 2 to 3 months from now. The first batch of talent track students in Nigeria started in the month of April 2017, and they just started now. So obviously, if you ask me that if it's tested outside to the industry, not yet. But the program was developed in the last 2 years and started implementing about 4 months back in India for the first time. But the idea is so that this kind of model is unique on its own. There is no direct comparison of what it is. Of course, a Shell Drop-Down Round 2 or BP's high-value drilling or ExxonMobil's internal training model for the in-house staffs are well-known, well-reputed. But from an independent training company's point of view, talent track is unique and there is no direct comparison. Of course, to answer your question, we cannot demonstrate that how it is working in the industry. But based on the model what we developed, we are very confident that it is going to work out very well. We can see that the value from the trainees ongoing right now, with the 7 trainees in India and about 5 trainees in Nigeria. And if you are interested, we can sit across a table with you and go through the elements and modules, how we are going to train more in details. That will probably give you a better answer.
Thank you very much, Kumar.
So it's still on the talent track. You had mentioned your ability to transform a fresh engineer into a competent one in 6 years, against 2 years. 6 months. Thank you. And against two to three years on the field. You've mentioned things like webinars, projects and exams and all of that, which is fine. And but the two things I want to clarify is how long, you have also talked about practical exposures. So how long is this practical exposure in the course of the 6 months training? And what is it that is different that you're bringing to the table as against a normal engineer interacting with his superiors in the office and having such exposures? What are you bringing to the table that is able to make you shorten a 2 to 3 year cycle to a 6 month cycle? Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Again, a very good question. The fundamental difference is that in the traditional model, let's say a fresh engineer is given to a supervisor, a senior drilling engineer, and then he works under him for some time. But what happens is that particular model has got a boundary conditions on his own. For example, the senior drilling engineer will have his own boundary conditions because he will be working on a particular aspect of well construction. He won't be doing the entire model. And when a trainee is working under him, he will also have a boundary conditions of task assigned to him. Simple example, if I am a fresh engineer, I am working with a senior drilling engineer, and the drilling engineer is working on a particular drilling program, a particular aspect of a drilling program or a well execution model, I will be trained by him only on that. Secondly, he does not have time to train me to the level I want to train. He's going to be training on hands-on model, giving some jobs here and there, give some assignment grasp everything out. You will not have time to develop the fundamental knowledge what is required. What we're doing, what is different here is that we're not going to the practical aspects of hands-on training. We are giving the fundamental concepts and the fundamental laws of executing a project from the concept stage all the way into completion stage. Once you have the fundamental knowledge, as I told you earlier on, there will be a lot of methods of doing an activity, but if the fundamental ruling laws are very few. If I know all the ruling laws very nicely, then I will be able to devise my own models. And that efficiency will come in very easy. This is called McKinsey model. Okay, simple example is this whole thing is driven out of the McKinsey model. The McKinsey model has been one of the most successful models in the world in all the industries. It was never applied to the oil and gas industry. In the McKinsey model, what it says that is, in the olden days, people take 30 to 40 years to come to a senior level, like a CTO or a CFO or a CEO or even a chairman of the company. To come to that level, they take 30 to 40 years in the corporate level. Somebody with 20 years of experience, or at the age of 30 or 45, only they become a big leader. But the McKinsey model proved, without any doubt, that people with 5 years of experience, 10 years of experience, at the age of 25, at the age of 30, they become CEOs. And so today, if you look at the world, people who follow the McKinsey model, at the age of 28, people are chief financial officer, chief financial directors. It is basically understanding the fundamental laws of business. And nobody has tried that model in the industry. Even Shell or BP has not tried. They have tried the traditional model of, even Shell down is a traditional model. It's not a McKinsey model. For the first time in the industry, we are bringing the McKinsey model to that.
Practical exposure?
I think the exposure is not in the first 6 to 9 months. At the end of the 6 to 9 months, depending upon the situation, we will and the fact that people, for example, in the well construction well engineering model, there are two people focusing on well construction design engineers in the office. They will be given exposure at the 6 to 9 months. It's not a mandatory requirement, depending upon their expectations. After that, once you have the fundamental, again the same principle comes in. For example, if I go to the rig, today I go to the rig without knowing anything as a training. I will learn the practical aspects of doing a thing based on how a two pusher on the rig is running. I will only know what a two pusher knows, or a driller knows, or a roughneck knows. I was a driller roughneck one time when I was learning. That's why I lost my two fingers. And but I was only taught what my driller knew. I cannot learn anything beyond that. Even if you want to try something new, you say, you know what they call in the industry. Just go into whatever I'm telling you. So basically your knowledge development is very limited in somebody working on a grid. But if I have a fundamental loss, fundamental approach, fundamental principles known about it, when I go to the rig, I'm not going to be a drilling rig person. I'm going to be an operator's drilling engineer. I want to know what is happening on the rig, how they're executing the job. For that to understand, again the McKinsey model comes in the picture. For example, a guy who trained in McKinsey model for 2 years has established, well proven, the statistics are there. Then he went to the stock markets and established fantastic models far better than somebody working for 30 years in this market. So this is the model which we are using.
Thank you.
Greetings. I believe this is quite an innovation that we should encourage. Globally, our industry is a big data environment. And the Internet of Things analytics is becoming a dominant area for training in other industries. I would encourage that SpringRock look into this area also, because it would be a lot of data. But the oil industry is notorious for not having used this data in a probabilistic form most times that we deterministic. But the industry is growing now, and outside the country, a lot of training centers are emerging in the area of Internet of Things analytics. So I would encourage that you look into this and incorporate it into your training programs.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
I need a clarification before I make my comment. Is Spring Rock, is it global or is it regional?
Thank you, sir, for that question. SpringRock is a Nigerian company. It
it's wholly 100% Nigerian. But to answer your question specifically, SpringRock is currently present in 5 countries. Nigeria, Kenya, United States, Mauritius, and Seychelles. Also, to bring some context to it, SpringRock currently has 10 nationalities working with SpringRock. Within Nigeria, we're 90% Nigerian content. So the model is, it's a Nigerian organization, driven out of Nigeria, but we also want to attract other nationalities, primarily because we don't want to get into what we all know is called a groupthink, and we also want to be able to look at things from several different perspectives.
Then, following up with what you said, I think there's an opportunity for you guys to get into an application together and do a lot of catamaran, because there are lots to be done there, and you can't achieve anything without having a proper database and data mining. What I did here in your presentation is, what are the likely challenges you suspect that SpringRock might encounter in this operating environment that is full of fiscal uncertainty, full of other uncertainties that obviously nobody can give you an answer immediately. So these are the kind of things. Let's look at the other side. Let's not only look at what you can offer as services. So let's also look at the challenges you've identified and how you intend to mitigate them. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Well, as a well engineer, I would have failed if I did not make a comment in a gathering like this. First of all, let me make 2 remarks on your comment on Makanda, and the second comment was Makese model. There's no investor that will take a loan if the well engineer is going to be a 6-month trained well engineer that is going to drill the well. I'm very sure the bankers will not ensure they will give the loan to that investor or that company to drill those wells. Therefore, I hear you very, very well. When you have a kick or you're going to get a blowout, very experienced people go in. A very old drilling practice is what survives. When you see pressure on the surface, the 6 months will run away from the rig. Okay, it doesn't mean that I am not new and that I want you to remain old-fashioned, but it is that it's experience, practice, and so on that enable you to go close to that BOP, close it, and operate the choke when you have pressure. Makondo, I don't know if I agree that it is this simplified model of, you call it unconscious incompetence.
Conscious
incompetence. No. BP will not, in such a very high pressure, very expensive, deep water horizon, BP will not put people that we are consciously incompetent in charge of that operation. What happened was what we call risk normalization. If it was an average experienced well engineer that was in charge, when he sees that pressure during the flow check, he will be worried. He will say, my book says, once there is pressure, don't knock it and say, well, it's coming from trapped pressure. He won't do that. When we're young, reading your book and following your procedures, you make sure you follow the procedure. But it is very experienced, I think it's just pressure. Move on. So that's risk normalization. I believe that listening to Andrew Hopkins 2 days ago, that's about the same thing he was saying about it. Not recognizing it. It isn't quite that they didn't know. Money was also driving them. So when we know so much and we succeeded in normalizing risk, then we allow the very disastrous occurrence and observation, we commonize it and just push it away, move on. And that's why, that's the conclusion that most of us drew from it. Having said that, I commend you, and I believe that working with IEDC, you are in IEDC, you can come with what I know I suggested at the beginning of last year, how to recover from this drop in activity. Activity dropped. Those who were in the oil field, they are not maintaining their experience. When you keep drilling and you're making a mistake and all that, you are still acquiring experience. You build it up. But if activity drops, people become rusty. It is institutions like this that to refresh people quickly and make them come back. So don't make the price too expensive, otherwise the independent like ITO and all that will not, they won't pay. So make sure that it is what they can afford so that you refresh it. There's huge opportunity in Nigeria for you to do refreshing. I'd like to see where you fully set up, where is your sim well, how are you going to test, practical hands-on when it's there. I don't agree that 6 months is the time that you can quickly rush through. And even the shared model of round one and round two, the training, classroom training, and the practical training. Outside, going to the rig is more than 6 months. Therefore, I know you can be intensive, but what you need to learn to become a competent and confident well engineer is more than 6 months. But work with IEDC, especially IEDC, then we can put this. And when the practical come, I'll learn my opportunity, work around with some people so that we can continue to give you a challenge and criticize for improvement. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Just as two questions, one from you and then one for Ike. And the first question, you talked about competency certification. Are you, is it going to be in the form of SP, IITC, or is it going to be in MMS? Or are you going to develop your certification or training that will compete with this global certification company? That's what I want to do. Are you going to compete or you want to go to alliance with them to satisfy the trainings after 6 months? And okay, I looked at the group under SpringRock and I begin to wonder, are they working independently or as a group, as a one entity? Because I could begin to see lots of overlap. The way I picture you, because I cannot. I look at M Consult and I also look at Alliance and find out, are they independent company or you work together as a group? And that would be my comment to you.
Okay, so thank you. I'll answer your first question. Nikkei can answer the second one. Alliance with SPE or IADC is a kind of a different model for this because. Even for example, Shell Round 1 and Round 2 or similar models available in the industry, there is no certification alliance with SPE or IEDC because they do not do models like this. The current models of SPE and the current models of IEDC, they are not the same genuine as what we have in Talent Track. So Talent Track is kind of, as I mentioned in one of the benchmarking, it surpasses the SPE's competency certification requirement. Also surpasses all the IADC's competency requirement, as IADC mostly concentrates and focuses on operations on the rig, whereas SPE focuses on general on well design, well engineering, well competency, but it is kind of limited compared to Talent Track. So right now, in the future, we'll be trying to align with SPE and may not be IADC, because IADC may not be entering into the well construction model. SPE will be definitely interested in that. Also in some other forum, but as of now, the accreditation is not, will not really take me from the SPE. The certificate will be given by SpringRock certified by the experts, what we have. The experts, what we have is a forum or a panel in SpringRock. They have extremely extensive experience in the industry, in every aspect of it. The certificate exams, what we have here, is far more tougher than what we have even in the other institutes. For example, we have analyzed the type of questions and challenges come from the certification exams of SPE and IADC and everywhere. And our model have far tougher and difficult questions for children to attend to. So it will be certified by the experts panel of SpringRock. We have a panel of experts in all the disciplines and they will be certified.
Let me answer your question on how the individual groups work. The simple answer is yes, while they are individual businesses, but they work relatively hand in hand. And also, the other thing that we tried to do was to ensure that one group can leverage from the other. But we also wanted to, if you like, compartmentalize in a way to have some focus. You could actually eliminate Crystal Industries and have M Consults do everything, but then they will go from well construction to production. So we wanted to have a different group that's just focused on production and another group that's focused on well construction. So M Consults can come into play from when you acquire the asset until when you have a well drill and you hook it up to production. Then Crystal Industries plays from there to the other end of it.
Thank you. Any more questions?
All right. I want to ask just one question, but I'd like to start by saying, I mean, it's a good concept that you have, Gemini Resources. Right now, I'm aware and we know that many operating companies, they have what they call the graduate trainees, which they also they get fresh graduates, train them, and they'll put them in the system. And that is basically part of the things you want to do. Now, your trainees, are they going to be coming from, you know, corporate organizations only? Or is it open to also individuals who are coming out of university, they want to be trained, and you are accommodating them, or you just basically want to get them from corporate organizations? And train them and then put them back into the system.
Thank you very much. The answer to that question is it's we want the trainees to come from corporate organizations. They could also walk through the street and come in. What really happens today is if you wanted to hire 5 engineers, for example, you're going to interview them and put them through certain tests, and then you say some of them are not good enough, and then they go back to the street. So we actually welcome those who were found not good enough when they came to your interview, and we believe that by the time they've passed 6 months with us, they'll become good enough. And to be quite frank with you, we had a recruitment exercise not too long ago, and we've actually gone back to all the people that fell below our cut and told them, if you want, you can come for a training. We believe that if you've gone through that training, you'll be able to make our cut and make somebody else's cut. Yes.
Any more questions? Comments, advice? If not, ladies and gentlemen, from the grapevine, I hear that dinner is ready. That's going to be the next item on the agenda. But I will also let you feast your eyes on some of the pictures you see around here. They're telling the message of change. You see what the world is.
Thank you very much, Ben. This is not part of the agenda, but please permit me to recognize 3 of my employees who are here. The video that you saw was actually not made by Hollywood or Bollywood or Nollywood or whatever wood. It's actually Springwood. Where's Vivian? So Vivian, please. Okay. So the movie that you watched actually was put together by these two ladies. Vivian has an engineering degree, project manager. She's a cost optimization engineer, so she's not from a movie making background. Edidion just finished her youth service. She's an accountant by training. But we challenged them, and I think you appreciate what they did put together. I had some suggestions here that we may be considering several business groups. So please,
Springwood.
When you have your need for videos, do remember us.
Okay.
I think it's also fair to recognize the person that supervised them. Nora, are you here? Okay, if you can leave the food alone for a while.
That's it, subsidiary.
So Nora supervised them to put this together, putting together the video and everything else that you saw today. These two ladies are responsible for that. Thank you very much.
Did he put together his presentation? Huh? Did he put together your presentation? I thought it was quite good too.
All right.
That's right, yes.
Yeah,
so ladies and gentlemen, confirmation, food is ready? Okay, so it's going to be, dinner is going to be upstairs. We go through this staircase. We are not bringing the food down here. The table set for dinner out there. So please, help yourself. Enjoy the meal.
I'm going to go to the next one.
platform. One of my
charities.
So you'll be able to eat.
So I won't be able to eat.
But I don't eat that much anyway. I had lunch.
Once I eat lunch, I don't eat dinner.
When I get out of my apologies, that I won't be able to.
When I get out of my
Thank you very much.
I don't think we have met.
My name is Lai Fatima.
Okay.
Right.
swearing on him.
He says, last Christmas.
You made him give me the connection.
I
beg of him.
He says, I beg of him.
I want to record that we are eating the food. But when it comes to the
Oh,
but you don't go anywhere. So you're just staying out. So that's.
Sonny,
Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, Sonny, S